VPs, Turning My Heartbeat Up, the Northern Soul tune. Chain suggestions wanted, please. Nihal's here tomorrow, but we'll be back next week and we'll want your chain suggestions, please. Linking into our Pick a Rose from My Rose by Marv Johnson. Brett Anderson, the brilliant Brett Anderson of Suede, has a new memoir out called Afternoon with the Blinds Drawn. It's out now, his second volume, following on from Cold Black Mornings, which came out last year. You'll hear me speaking to him after my favourite Suede record. Certainly my favourite Suede single, and I will brook no argument. We are the Pigs. We Are the Pigs by Suede, one of my very favourite Suede records, by way of introduction to my guest, Brett Anderson. Hello, Brett.
Hi, Stuart. How are you doing?
I'm very well, and I've very much enjoyed Afternoons with the Blinds Drawn, which is your second volume of memoir.
That's right. Second one.
Second volume of memoir.
I know.
And I'm going to, if you hear the little rustle from time to time, there's me actually turning the pages in the book.
That's nice. It gives it a nice little sort of verite touch, doesn't it? You know.
So here, and I quote, so here I sit writing the book I said I wouldn't write, talking about the things I said I didn't want to talk about. I suppose it was inevitable.
Mm.
Did you feel a certain inevitability, or were you really at some point thinking, no, I don't want to go to those places? And
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's kind of, you know, what I write is how I felt. I honestly didn't think I was going to write this volume. I wrote Cold Black Mornings specifically because I didn't want to go to this period of history and to kind of write about the well-trodden kind of, you know, story that happened to us after we became successful, because I felt as though I didn't really have any ownership over that story because I'd been told so many times before by other people, by the press and stuff. So I thought, well, if I'm going to talk about it, because I did enjoy the whole process of writing, I thought, well, I've got to find my own entry point into this. And so I tried to, instead of just sort of like recounting the kind of events that happened in the 90s, I tried to sort of look at myself almost as a sort of specimen that had gone through the fame machine, that had gone through the kind of success machine and been spat out the other end sort of thing, and look at that journey and look at it in almost a sort of a meta sense, and look at it almost as if I'm a kind of like a, like I'm looking at someone else. And I think the hindsight of history enabled me to do that.
That's really interesting, because some of the things that absolutely struck me very early on reflect that sense, in that you say you felt, you've always felt your career is like a pram careering downhill out of your control.
Pram pushed down a hill or
that's
something.
That's right. And you also say, rather brilliantly, I think, that you've never felt that, unlike Lydon or unlike Dylan or unlike Bowie, I think, unlike artists from the past, the Dylan, the Lydons, the Bowies, I don't think I was ever particularly in control of the manufacture of my persona.
No,
that's
no.
Really interesting. Say a little more about that.
Yeah, well, I think, you know, with the case of those artists, it was much more conscious. And I think in the 90s there was a kind of conscious rejection of those values, you know, those sort of like quite 1980s values of pop stars being kind of manufactured and presenting personas and stuff like that. And I think there was a movement in the 90s that was much more about kind of, I think, an attempt at realism in music. And I think I was sort of tied up within that zeitgeist, and so I didn't consciously manufacture a persona. But I make the point in the book about how the manufacture of persona is inevitable and unavoidable, because it's part of the process of just being in the public eye. No matter how much you're not consciously manufacturing a persona for yourself, one gets manufactured for you by the kind of like the way that the image gets refracted through the press and reflected back at you and all these things. And it's not necessarily kind of, people are very suspicious of the concept of persona because they feel as though they're being manipulated by a false character. But I think my point is that the persona is just something that we kind of inhabit in everyday life, really. You know, when you go to a party or whatever, the you that you present is different from the you that sits down and watches the TV or something like that. But when you're in the public eye, when you're on stage, all of these things, it's just magnified, it's just heightened. And I suppose I was just trying to make that point.
You talked about the press, though. You mentioned the press, and it's so inextricably linked because of the early kind of tsunami of praise and attention. Not always just praise, attention that Suede received.
Yeah, yeah.
I always feel a little sheepish about this. We've talked about this before, being intimately involved in that, select cover with the Union Jack.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Again,
I'll forgive you.
Hope you have.
It was a long time ago.
It was a long time ago, and I hope you all. I hope also that I've tried to make the point before that what happened was a Frankenstein's monster was created that you were one facet of, and probably the least willing facet
It's interesting because I've always been quite critical of kind of Britpop and Cool Britannia and all these kind of things, and you know it's easy I don't want to be kind of cast as this sort of like curmudgeon that just like slags it off, but I think all of these things, they start off with good intentions. You know, they are all kind of youth movements, you know, from sort of rock and roll to punk to whatever. They all sort of start off with good intentions, and then they sort of become, the money moves in, and they become sort of sanitised and distorted and cheapened. And that's exactly what happened with Britpop, you know, or what became known as Britpop. You know, 1992, the songs that we were writing in 92 and 91, you know, I was sort of documenting myself as a sort of poor, marginal, disenfranchised Englishman.
Yes.
And London happened to be the kind of the sort of, you know, the setting for that. Yeah. And I was just reflecting the world I saw around me.
Yeah.
And later that kind of got sort of hijacked a little bit, I felt, and turned into something a little bit with shades of nationalism and stuff like that at its worst element. But my point is that it started off with good intentions, I think, you know.
I love that you have your own little sort of revenge escape valve in the form of the mythical band Bruiser, which is your kind of lumpen Britpop act, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly. But, you know, whatever you say about Britpop, and I've said lots of bad things about it, you know, it was a powerful kind of movement. And what I think, without wishing to get too sort of like, you know, chin-strokey and sort of pseudo-intellectual about it, its value was that it was a rejection of American culture and imperialism. All the bands sort of like, you know, this is kind of like this sort of almost like you have to sing in an American accent, you have to sing about California, this sort of like all of these rock cliches and stuff like that, and Britpop went against that. It said no, we're going to sing about the world that we see around us. You know, we don't live in California. I lived in, you know, West London, and you know, I kind of traipsed to the Dole office on Edgware Road every 2 weeks. Do you know what I mean? In shoes that had holes in them. Do you know what I mean?
That
was my world. I wasn't in a Cadillac on Route 101, you know, so I wanted to sing about my world, and it was a rejection of that kind of like deluge of American cultural imperialism, which I'm kind of quite proud of instigating.
Yeah. You summed that sort of idea up brilliantly when you said that all great, I'm not sure if this world of pop and rock still exists anymore, but you said that all great bands of new bands like that, there's something Oedipal about them, something patricidal. You want to destroy the people who came before.
Of course, that's part of almost like it was the duty of new bands to kind of look at the previous generation of bands and say, you know, we reject everything about them. We're something different. We feel new. And I think it was kind of easier for Suede because it felt in the early 90s when we appeared that the scene was tired, to say the least, without kind of naming names and particular bands involved, it felt like it really needed a breath of fresh air. And that's why I think Suede were kind of, you know, leapt upon by the press. And you know this because you were there, because I think the press were just very excited about what we were doing. We were doing something fresh, new, that had a kind of a completely different energy to everyone else.
And I can tell you exactly what it felt like. I can remember sitting at the NME office being so bored with the music we were putting on the cover with the plaid shirted American, you know, and someone going to the office cassette player and saying, I've got this Suede demo. And an absolute, revelatory moment of thank God.
Yes,
it really was like that. Yeah. It really was like that, and you know,
it felt like it, and it was very, very exciting at the time to sort of be on the cusp of that. you know, and that was the exciting time for me. You know, that was why I kind of like, you know, that was the really valuable thing to be part of something before it became defined was so exciting. Yeah. When we were writing those songs in the very early 90s, in 1991 and 1992, before it had become defined, and we didn't quite know what it was, so it was still sort of forming. Yeah. You know, we didn't have, it wasn't labelled yet, and that was, I'm not kind of like, there's nothing wrong with labelling, things inevitably get labelled. But it was just that exciting moment where it felt like we were sort of explorers.
Yeah.
You know, you're kind of cutting your way through the forest with a machete. Yeah. And you know what I mean? It was that sense, you know, and we didn't quite know where we were going. And making that debut album and singing about the issues at the, you know, on that debut album did feel like we were doing something that was a little bit bigger than just our own petty concerns. It felt like that we there was a sort of like a purpose that was somehow sort of, you know,
felt
without wishing to come across as self-important, it felt like we were doing something worthwhile, you know.
You're very hard on some of your own records, like Stay Together, and you also, conversely, you mentioned some records that you don't think have perhaps got the attention they deserve, and often you said, like the Smiths did, they were great B-sides. We're going to pause for one now called Europe Is Our Playground, which was, I think, a B-side, wasn't it?
It was the B-side to Trash,
What is it about this you particularly like?
I don't know. What is it about songs that are good? It's sort of, you know, how do you describe that? It's melodically, it works. There's something about the mood of it. I like it uses the metaphor of travel to describe the shifting phases of love, which I think is quite a neat little metaphor.
Yeah. This is Suede in Europe Is Our Playground. Europe Is Our Playground by Suede. I'm talking to Brett Anderson about this fantastic second volume of memoir, Afternoons with the Blinds Drawn. You talk about the darker elements of we've to mention that the Dogman Star period, when Bernard, tensions within the group are getting bad. You then also mention, you talk about another later period, beautifully, in a chapter called Quiet Ruin, which is about addiction.
Mm-hmm.
You talk about looking out of the window from this enclosed, rather dark and claustrophobic life you're leading, and looking at the summer house. You look at the summer house in your garden and say, this is something, a place of lightness and air that children should play in, and it feels very different from the existence you're living.
Yeah.
Again, you are poetic about what seems to be a very dark chapter. Now, was it difficult to write?
Very difficult to write, very difficult to write. And it's very hard to talk about addiction and drugs and all of these things without it becoming sensationalist. And the way I thought that I could deal with it is by not using any proper nouns. Because I think as soon as you use a proper noun, as soon as I name substances...
And you never do.
It can become taken out of context, and it suddenly has a life of its own. It becomes clickbait, blah, 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 blah. And I just didn't want to do that. I wanted to make sure that it was... That when I talked about it, it was always within context, sort of thing. And again, it's all part of the honesty of the book, where I'm kind of like, I'm looking at myself. I'm not kind of blaming anyone else. I'm not even kind of like blaming my childhood or anything like that. I'm not sort of saying that I'm kind of, you know, oh my God, I had this awful... I didn't have an awful childhood. I had quite a happy childhood. It was more of a kind of a sort of romantic kind of belief in, I don't know, some sort of fantasy sort of transgressive world, you know, and inevitably kind of got out of control, you know.
Were you to some degree leading the kind of life you thought Brett Anderson of Suede ought to lead?
Yeah, absolutely. I was very much kind of like bought into my own kind of like the sort of, you know, I was very, very much kind of like smothered by the shadow of my own persona, I suppose.
Right.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. It's interesting that you sort of come out of that phase. I didn't realise this. Is it Surrey that you take yourself off to for a little while?
Yeah, I went to this weird little village called Chipstead. Just to kind of like, it was like a stockbroker belt. It was just this sort of odd little house I had. Yeah.
But what's interesting is in that period where you're walking around in the afternoons down these kind of, I believe what people nowadays in psychogeographic terms called liminal spaces,
that's right,
edgelands. And what's interesting, I thought, and I think you allude to it yourself in the book, is how that world a lot later, informs The Blue Hour, your most recent record, which is a fabulous record.
Thank you.
You know, I mean, right up there with the best things you've ever done. But it is that world of sort of... that was percolating in your mind for a long time.
It was, and when that was percolating, it was sort of like, it felt... It was interesting. I couldn't use it as a device, as a theme for a record at the time, because it felt like we were still trying to be part of the mainstream. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't until I felt as though we were set adrift from the mainstream, which we are now, you know, I have to be honest, that I felt as I had the freedom to do something that interesting. You know, there's no way that I could have written songs like the sort of songs that appeared on the new album, things like Dead Bird and Roadkill and all of these things, Beyond the Outskirts, which are about a very sort of dark vision of the countryside. They wouldn't have sat very kind of comfortably next to sort of pop stuff on Radio 1, which is where we were sort of still aiming at. But that's a really interesting thing, what happens to you in your career. And when you are set adrift from the mainstream, the kind of freedoms that gives you as an artist, and there's a beauty in that. And once you embrace that, I think there's a real power to that. And that's what we've done recently. You know, what we're trying to do as a band now is kind of go to places that we simply couldn't have gone to in the 90s, because you're sort of forced into this little sort of media infrastructure.
Just in case anyone also thinks, I mean, it is a candid book, and it's a deep book, and it's an intense book, but just in case anyone thinks it's not, there are also moments of great humour in it, I thought. I love the fact that I think one of the early Suede records was demoed as Dixon, because it was reminiscent of the Dixon of Dixon of Dot Green.
Yeah, that was one of, yeah. I mean, yeah. Yeah, there was all sort of funny little things like that.
On your first trip to America, I believe you make your own cheese and pickle sandwich for the plane. That's an incredible detail.
That's right, yeah. I liked putting in, you know, all the details that I put in there were all sort of things that only I could know. And I quite like that. Do you know what I mean? It was an attempt to sort of like reclaim some of the story for myself. It wasn't the headlines. It was like funny little things like that. It was the kind of the girl in the bar that kind of turned round to me and told me that she thought my band was rubbish. You know, things like that. Little details like that wouldn't be in the press.
So we've had Cold Black Mornings. We've had Afternoons with the Blinds Drawn. Mm. Are we going to get Some Enchanted Evening?
Parents' evenings, I think we'll go for. You know, my experience is doing the school run. There'll be, you know, the world's most boring book. not for a while. I think I'm going to have a bit of space from it, yeah.
Okay. And Suede, are we move ever onwards with Suede?
We always move ever onwards. We're always writing. We're in the middle of writing a new album at the moment. I'm very excited about, always excited about writing a new album. I'm trying to, we've made two albums that have been very kind of narrative-based, slightly florid records about family, and I want to make something that's much more kind of rocky and simple and nasty now.
Right, great. We'll look forward to it. It's always a pleasure to talk to you, Brett.
Thank you, Stuart.
Brett Anderson there, and Afternoons with the Blinds Drawn is out now. We're getting so much of a reaction to that, and we've got so little time. We'll keep some of these for when we return next weekend, Mark and I. But I will just say that Jenny in Dundee was one of the kids in the music video for We Are the Pigs, which is fantastic. The others were my brothers, sisters and chums, says Jenny in Dundee. Leave you with Emil and the Sniffers. Bye-bye. Emil and the Sniffers. You look nice as a girl.